Good evening.
Good evening.
This is the school. Welcome to another lesson sponsored by the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organizations. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, scientific, and research organization dedicated to showing proof in existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was founded as a result of divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. The school was incorporated in the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools in the United States and in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and original names and title of the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Father is Yahweh, and it has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word of Son is Elohim, and it has been improperly substituted by God. The true name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God, they are titles, they are not names. As the Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5, there's Lord's many, and there's God's many. But we now know that every Lord must have a name, and every God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a title that the Creator has chosen for himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. In my investigation on your part, in any good dictionary or encyclopedia, will prove to you that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, or the Latin language had any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in any other language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and correct name of the Father. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, the substance, the limits, the bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose the cloud to symbolize himself because the cloud had no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of the chart to show you how that everything on the chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word of Son, a super incorporeal being that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This spirit form can only be seen in divine visions and understood divine revelations. This self-same spirit later manifested in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua Messiah, in whom the world called Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name unto salvation, we should all know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading a preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him this tabernacle pattern in a vision. He later instructed him to build one in the wilderness exactly like the one that he saw in the mount. Now the tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth to show proof in this school how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional objectives of the school are and aims are as follows. First, is to help you find and know Yahweh Elohim as he really is and as he has exists. Second, form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, the so-called law of nature, and the powers laid in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult sciences. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seven is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan, his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eight is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith, which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is to speak the truth. We're going to start this morning class with the evening class with the prayer of Dr. Will Williams. We're going to also have a scripture lesson with Dr. Kenwood Kleinsmith, 1 John, 1st chapter.
Importantly, a better understanding of what you have shown so that we may have a more perfect understanding of who you are, what you are, what you're doing, where we are in your purpose and plan so that we may live in you consciously for all throughout all eternity. These things we ask in the name of your only begotten Son, Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
be reading from the Holy Name Bible, edited by A.B. Train of the Scripture Research Association and republished by Yahshua Promotions. 1 John 1. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son, Yahshua the Messiah. And these things we write unto you, that your joy may be full. This then is the message we have heard of him, and declare unto you that Yahweh is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Yahshua the Messiah, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. If we say that we have not sinned, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. That was 1 John 1. Let us all say,
Amen.
This is our worship night, workshop night. What we're going to do is call our first speaker, Dr. Will Williams.
This great and awesome panoramic vision of revelation bequeathed to us by Yahweh Elohim, as was stated in this workshop night, and we like to get into the nuts and bolts of things, so that we hope that you can better well understand these charts, that is to say, how to use these charts so that you can ascertain the principles that are inherent therein. Okay. Are there any questions, comments, statements, anything anybody like to bring up or would like to explore? Or would you like to stick your hand in the numbers jar?
Somebody talked about the two Elohims. You want to talk about that?
The two Elohims.
There are no two
Elohims. I'm acquainted with it, and I don't know how that got started. But actually, it's a semi-Christian concept, because the Mormons believe that. Well, see if I remember right. The way the Mormons put it is that Elohim had two sons, Jesus Christ and Satan, and they fought over the, you know, who should populate the earth. Because see, the Mormons believe that they have to populate the universe, literally. I mean, not just here on earth, but other planets as well. They believe that. And so there was a war in heaven, and Satan and his host was cast out down here to the earth. And they became the dark-skinned peoples of the earth. And when Jesus Christ came down and his followers, they became the lighter-skinned peoples of the earth. Okay. So yeah, that's what the Mormons believe. Yeah. Of course, they've had to modify it over the years, you know, that kind of thing. They wouldn't let black people be the bishop,
right?
You know, join the priesthood, you know, that kind of thing. So, but to address the issue of the two Elohims, which I heard was supposedly somebody, you know, folks are trying to say that, well, Satan is the equal of Elohim. And that's just not so. Because one, Elohim is the begotten son of the Father, and he is the creator, whereas Satan is just the created. Now, we say this all the time. We say this about Satan, that he is the mystery of iniquity. Can we look up the word iniquity? And I want the etymology of it as well. Yeah. Iniquity. Hello, anybody?
My throat. Iniquity.
Yes?
I'm trying to find it. Gross injustice. Gross injustice. Wickedness.
I want the etymology.
The etymology.
It's right there before you get to the definition.
Iniquitous.
Hello?
I don't see it in
the... Why don't you bring it to me? Maybe I'll translate it.
Etymology? Iniquite.
I'm waiting for something. Am I going to get anything?
Here.
Huh?
Iniquite, it says. Iniquitous. Iniquus, uneven.
Is that it? Anything? I mean,
plus, aqueous,
unfairness,
equal.
Injustice.
Speak up.
Unfairness, injustice. Unjustice.
That's the etymology, not the definition. I want the etymology of the word. Do y'all understand what I'm asking for when I ask for etymology? You kind of read it a little bit. I want the word itself. The definition is fine, but I want... Thank you.
Medieval is iniquite. That's all that's written here.
It's not making sense. Can you bring that to me, please? It's not making sense. I'm sorry. Maybe I'm dense tonight, okay? But it's not making sense. Okay. Iniquity. All right. Okay, here's how you decipher a dictionary, okay? Now, in fact, I will write it up here. I will put this up here for me. What in the world? How did this get wet? We're having a lot of things happening tonight. We almost didn't broadcast. Okay, now, this is what the dictionary says, okay? This is the etymology. All right. Thank you.
This is what I mean by the etymology. This is what usually precedes a word, I mean, precedes the definition right after the word.
Well, that's what I said.
Oh, listen, may I do this? Okay? Now, this is ME. What does that stand for?
Middle English.
Middle English. This word comes, the word iniquity comes from the Middle English word iniquité, which comes from Middle French, iniquité, which comes from Latin, iniquita, from iniquus, which means uneven, which comes from the combination of in plus aqueous. The word aqueous means equal. In this case means not. See, now that's how you read a dictionary. See, and see, in these terms, they have these terms in the dictionary. There's a page in here where it tells you, you know, what these initials stands for, Middle English, Middle French, Latin, and then you say, well, what is that? Then just simply look up Middle English. And then when you look up Middle English, it should say, middle, and it says Middle English, the English in use from the 12th to the 15th century. See, this word here comes from that time period. See, now if I was to look up Middle French, and it's pretty close by, it'll say the French in use from the 14th to 16th century. This word here. Then this comes from Latin, which goes all the way back. And then it shows you the Latin, and in the Latin, the word, this word, which means uneven, which is a combination of these two words. Now that's the origin or the history of that word. See, the point I wanted to draw out was simply, the word means unequal. The word means unequal. So Satan is the mystery of unequalness. So if he's unequal, then he cannot be equal to Elohim, because he's created to be that. However, because of the task he's been given, at least as far as we're concerned, we wouldn't know any difference. See? Because we'll extol him, I'm talking about Lucifer, as Elohim, or whatever he proposes as that. That's why we have this chart. See these empires. See, he said, I will be like the Most High. That's his thing. I will be like the Most High. Well, then, okay, fine. What is the Most High like? What is the Most High like? That's the thing you should ask. If he's going to be like the Most High, then you have to ask, well, what is the Most High like?
Perfect.
See? Okay, we'll take that. The Most High is perfect. So how does Lucifer try to be perfect?
Being like Elohim.
See, to be like Elohim. How? See, in a physical sense, in a great massive sense, that's why this is here. Human government. See, because human government, to govern. See, to govern, see, if Satan is going to be like the Most High, then he's going to copy every aspect of Elohim.
Very good.
Okay? If Elohim wants to be worshipped, then Satan wants to be worshipped. If Elohim has a kingdom, then Satan has to create a kingdom. Okay? It's really that simple. That's why plates 1, 2, and 26. Maybe we could try something here.
You can stay one spot.
I'll stay still. I will stand still. Okay, thank you. Let me do this first.
All right. And we got Elohim here. All right, this is Elohim. This is him and his great heavenly anthropomorphic being. This is the shape and form. And here's Lucifer. Same way. You know, got his arms folded. He's got a beard. Okay. All right. This, you know, and so he's going to imitate. This is trying to imitate this. You have 9 attributes embedded in the kingdom. In principle, when you look at these human governments, they represent their manifestations of attributes in a kingdom. I mean, all governments try to exhibit wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, mm-hmm. beauty, love, justice, foundation, power. All governments do that. Okay. The way they do it in a carnal way.
Right.
See? In a physical way, in a demonstrative way. Okay? Satan is just trying to copy that. I will be like the Most High. But the thing about it is, this is not equal to this. But to you, if you don't know any better,
yes.
you think it's the best thing since sliced bread.
Yeah.
If you never saw the sun before, then the moon would be a pretty neat thing.
Right.
If you never saw the sun. I mean, because the moon is the bright object in the sky, brighter than the stars, and moves across the sky, goes through its phases and whatnot. You think, oh, wow, that's really nice. I mean, and people have been impressed by the moon. We have calendars.
That's right.
By the moon. Lunar calendars, you know, because people observe the moon, worship the moon, things like that. But then when the sun comes, that's a whole different story. Because then the sun just wipes everything out. When the sun comes up, the moon is gone, the stars are gone, and it's just the sun and its strength. Okay? That's what this is. Whereas he himself, this, represents a veil. And that's the thing a lot of people don't understand. That Satan is a veil. And that his job is to cover. Let's read it. We're talking all this stuff. Ezekiel. And but we'll start there. We'll start there.
Ezekiel 1.
Ezekiel 28:11.
Ezekiel 28:11. Moreover, the word of Yahweh came unto me, saying, Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, and uh-huh. say unto him,
uh-huh.
Thus saith Yahweh, thou sealest up the sum full of wisdom and perfect in beauty.
Mm-hmm.
Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Elohim.
Now, see, he's talking about Lucifer, okay? He said he's been in Eden, the garden of Elohim. Read.
Every precious stone was thy covering.
Now, every precious stone was thy covering. What precious stone is that? The attributes. It's his covering, just like the attributes are your covering. Are they not?
That's right.
You have a physical body, but that has 9 attributes. Actually, 10, because there are 9 embedded in the 10th attribute.
Right.
Your soul is literally as a covering.
Mm-hmm.
Because, see, your physical body are the attributes materialized in part. So you have a covering. You're covered in attributes, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
So is he. The same attributes. Read.
The sardius.
1.
Topaz.
2.
And the diamond.
3.
The beryl.
4.
The onyx.
5.
And the jasper.
6.
The sapphire.
7.
The emerald.
8.
And the carbuncle.
9.
And gold.
10. 9 attributes embedded in 10. He's the same way. And he has all of them. Somebody's going to say they got love. Oh, yes, he does. He has love for his own. At least Yahshua said that, because if you can remember the scripture, because Yahshua did say, the world loves his own.
Luke.
See, well who is the world? This is the world. So yeah, he does love his own.
Luke 11:5.
I'm sorry?
Luke 11:5.
I cannot hear you.
Luke 11:5.
Luke 11:5.
Luke 11:5. And he said unto them, which of you shall have a friend and shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him,
mm-hmm.
friend, lend me three loaves, for a friend of mine.
No, that's the parable. I want the quote. That's the parable. You mean it's a nice parable.
If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he shall ask for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children.
Now, what would motivate an evil man to give good gifts to his children? Would it be love? Okay, read.
How much more shall your heavenly Father give good things to them that ask
him? And I hate that. So that's why I hate that verse. Because see, what does it say in the King James? That verse. Well,
I'm looking up for King James. Okay, Luke 11 and...
The verse you just read, the last verse you just read. Read that last verse.
If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much shall your heavenly Father give him the Holy Spirit to them that ask him?
Now, that's a lot better than just a good gift. See, to me, a Cadillac would be a good gift. You know, but I'd rather have the Holy Spirit. See, that's why you have to read both versions. So you know what, so you know what it is. That's a nice parable, but it's not quite what I wanted. Because there's a scripture where Yahshua says the world loves his own. It says that. I can't think where it's at. But the point is, Satan has all these attributes, okay? And he's manifesting them in the world through human government. See, that's how he's manifesting it. See, because the government will take on the role of a parent, of a mother or a father, or both. Especially if it's a cult of personality. When the person, if it's a guy, you know, oh, well, this is the great father, the benevolent father. Or if it's a queen, a woman, this is the great benevolent mother. She's going to take care of us, you know. She's going to look after us. If you do something wrong, she will punish you. You know, that kind of thing. And that's all governments are. See, and Satan, by creating these governments, what he's trying to do is imitate or recreate, according to his understanding, the Holy Spirit. That's really what it boils down to. Because the question you should ask is, what is it that could govern a person, or to make a person, as we would say, act right or do right, do the right thing? What could govern you? What would make you govern you to do that?
Laws.
Back here. With Nimrod. Because this is where Dr. Kennedy says human government really got codified. It started before then, because Cain had a government. And their government was like, hey, he was the top dog. And he was like, you know, if your family bad enough to kill us, you know, you go right ahead, because we'll get you. See, and nobody, and plus also he had a cult going. A lot of people don't realize that. Because they had the mark on his head, there was a cult of Cain or a religion of Cain where people would worship, because Cain was saying, see this mark? Well, who do you think put this mark up here? It was Elohim that did that. So now, Elohim did that. So, hey, but you think me and him time? You know, talk to me. Maybe I'll put in a good word for you. You know, that kind of thing. But now when you get here, okay, see here, this is where the effects of what Nimrod did still lingers on. That of human government. And see, when we say human government, we're talking about all spheres of society, see. Not just government, but religion, customs and mores, symbolism, things like that. It all comes from the Tower of Babel. It all started here. Okay? And see, and over time, it's just simply grown and modified. I mean, to the point that now, I mean, we have an internet, which is really, when you stop and think about it, is a universe in itself. you stop and think about it. And I mean, it's a vast universe. I'm talking about the digital world. It's a vast. I mean, they did a thing where they mapped the internet, and they said it looked kind of like a butterfly, but it was just endless for the most part, almost as endless as our universe. And see, and now they have things, you know, that they're inventing now, like virtual reality, where you can just put on some goggles and you can just step into that right. universe. Yeah. See, it's just a recreating of what's happening out here. And see, the thing about it is, that fueled with man's imagination and the satanic, you know, and look, when it comes to things carnal, the mystery of iniquity's got, you know, they got it all. We'll tell you this. He don't understand anything spiritual. But for this world, he doesn't have to. See, he's got the natural, the carnal, all down pat. So that he's gonna exercise to the fullest. Okay, so it's no marvel that you see many physical wonders now. You know, like the internet or things like that. You know, because it's an outgrowth of what started here. See, and it's always man's attempt to try to improve or do something better. And you know, and it's so ironic that now this argument now is about to shut down over a wall. We got to build a wall, you know. And you know something, it's so ironic because the whole thing about human government started with a wall. Because Nimrod, see, let's read it. Let's read the conditions out there. Then we'll kind of give you an idea of what's going on. It's the 9th chapter of Genesis. Did I have a scripture hanging? Okay.
9:1
we can start there.
Genesis 9:1 Mm-hmm. And Elohim blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them,
look at her.
Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens, upon all that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered. Every moving thing that liveth shall be food for you, even as the green herb have I given you all things. But flesh with life, which is in the blood, shall you not eat. And surely your blood of your lives will I require, at the hand of every beast will I require it, and at the hand of man, at the hand of every man's brother, will I require the life of man. Whoso sheddeth man's blood by men, shall his blood be shed. For in the image of Elohim made he man. And you be fruitful and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth, and multiply therein. And Elohim spake unto Noah and to his sons with him, saying, And I behold, I establish my covenant with you and with your seed after you, and with every living creature that is with you, of the fowl of the cattle, and of every beast of the field with you, from all that go out of the ark to every beast of the earth. And I will establish my covenant with you. Neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of the flood. Neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. And Elohim said, This is a sign of the covenant which I made between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a sign of a covenant between me and the earth. And it shall come to pass, when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you, and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh. And the bow shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between Elohim and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth.
Okay, that's good enough. All right, I know I had that's a bit much, but I had it read for a reason so that you can understand the conditions at the beginning of the post-diluvian age. Okay? So now, one, the fear of you and the dread of you is going to be on all the animals. All right? And every living thing for you will be as food for you. All right? And the flesh and, you know, and the flesh with life in it, which is the blood, you won't eat.
All right, and Yahweh established a covenant, saying that he put his bow in the clouds, showing that he would not destroy the earth anymore by water. Okay? So now that's some of the conditions that's happening at the beginning of this post-diluvian age. Now then, here we got Noah and his family, the ark resting on the mountains of Ararat, and they come out, and they go out, and they repopulate the earth, okay? Now remember, it said the fear of you and the dread of you are going to be on all the animals, all right? So there was a problem, see, because people would go out, because the animals came out first, and then the man, and animals being the territorial creatures that they are, they stake their claim, and then you come along, and you want to say, oh, this is a nice spot, I think I'll build my house there, make that my North 40, and, you know, build an irrigation ditch, and, you know, that's going to be all right. And next thing you know, you're out here, you plow in the field, and you set upon by a pack of wolves or something, you know? So the land cried out for a hero, and not just animals, but other peoples too. Two-legged animals, that is to say, you know, people, you know, worthless folks, lazy folks, who say, well, you know something? See them folks down in that valley? We'll let them work all summer. And then when the harvest time comes, we'll wait till they get the harvest in. And when they get the harvest in, we'll just go down and wait them. Who gonna stop us? You know? People like that. So the land cried out for a hero. See? Somebody to establish some law, some order. Genesis 10 and 8.
And Cush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before Yahweh. Wherefore, it is said, even as Nimrod the mighty hunter before Yahweh, in the beginning of his kingdom was Babel, and Erech, and Akkad, and Calneh in the land of Shinar. Out of that land went forth Ashur, and builded Nineveh, and the city Rehoboth, and Calah, and Razan between Nineveh and Calah, the same is a great city.
Okay, so now, that's Nineveh. He was a mighty hunter, all right? And so this guy, you know, he established law and order, you know, so to speak. All right? But it also, he also said this. He said that he was even the mighty hunter before Yahweh, meaning that he was against Yahweh. He was not for Yahweh. See, he's the mark of the beast. Okay? So now, Nimrod hit up upon a novel idea. And you can look, this is in a reference in the book, The Two Babylons, that he came up with a concept of walled enclosures. Now, walls are good for protection, you know, but like anything, they can be surmounted. But at that time, since it was a novel, new concept, see, because it would keep the animals out at the very least, and any two-legged animals that wanted to attack, it would have to be a more organized thing. They couldn't just walk into some village and just, you know, there's a wall up. So, you know, okay, well, gee, what do we do now? Well, either we got to batter it down or try to get over it or something, you know. It's not going to be just walking on in.
Right.
Okay? And so that was a novel concept that Nimrod came up with. Okay? He also came up with the idea for government, because it said he builded cities, right? And this was the novel concept he came up with, and that is the novel concept of taxation or tribute. In other words, Nimrod said, hey, I built this city, you come live here, but you gotta pay. My men gotta eat. Got some daughters, they could use some wives, but you worship me, you pay your taxes, this is what I'll do for you. I'll build the roads for you, okay? I'll make sure fresh water comes into the city. I'll have my men patrol the streets so you can open up a business and thieves will, you know, jump on you, you know, nothing like that. I'll have my men patrol so that way, you know, you can feel safe walking around here, that kind of thing. You know, I'll do this and I'll do, you know, but this is what you got to do. You got to pay, all right? And he came up with a public works project, see? And it's called the Tower of Babel. Okay?
Right.
Oh, I may as well. 22. See, he came up with a public works project here.
And see, we have here, it says the Satanic Foundation of the Tower of Babel. Okay, and then the Satanic Immersion, which is psychological. What do you mean? Well, see, if you remember, we had just read that Yahweh made a covenant with Noah, and he said that he was not going to destroy the earth by water because he put the bow in the cloud. Well, Nimrod and his boy said, we ain't going for that. You don't think so? Let's read it. That's Genesis 11 and 1.
Genesis 11 and 1.
Uh-huh.
And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there.
Mm-hmm.
And they said one to another, go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower.
Go ahead.
Whose top may reach unto heaven.
Uh-huh.
And let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth.
Now let us do this, and let us make us a name. In other words, let's make ourselves a name, lest we be scattered abroad. In other words, see, they remember, see, it wasn't the people that remembered, but it was the satanic spirits that were incarnated in them that remembered what happened in the last days.
That's right.
See, about a flood. And so they thinking, see, the satanic immersion is psychological. What do you mean? Look here. Look at the position here. All right. Draw a line. That's the brazen labor, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because these people were building a tower, they had water on the brain. Mm-hmm. They remembered the flood.
Right. Okay.
You understand?
Mm-hmm.
That was the psychological, that was the satanic immersion, which is psychological. In other words, in their minds, they're thinking, hey, the heck with that bow in the sky, you know, this Elohim, he may drown us out again. So let's just build a tower and make a name for ourselves, you know, lest we be scattered. See, that's the psychological immersion here. See, we see the satanic foundation because, see, look, they were already dead in their consciousness. They didn't know what they were doing, see, just like here. Alright, and see, and they come here and see, look, when, keep reading.
And Yahweh came down to see the city and the tower.
Now look, a lot of people won't say this, but this is an ascending and a descending plane. Why? Because here, the spirit law, the spoken word, the cloud. I have to find the lecture, but I do remember Dr. Kelly saying in a lecture that when this thing about the Tower of Babel happened, it was as like this heavy mist came down over them. That's why you have it illustrated here. Mm-hmm. See, this heavy mist coming down over them. See, here they are, they're building the building up, and this mist is coming down, and it's covering them. They're immersed in this mist, or a cloud, if you will. Okay, keep reading.
And Yahweh came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And Yahweh said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language. And this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So Yahweh scattered them abroad from thence,
mm-hmm.
upon the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because Yahweh did there confound the language of all the earth, and from thence did Yahweh scatter them abroad upon the face of all the earth.
Okay, now see, now they were scattered. All right, why? 8:37. And I want Job 1 and 6.
Job 1 and 6. Now there was a day when the sons of Elohim came to present themselves before Yahweh, and Satan came also among them.
Uh-huh.
And Yahweh said unto Satan, whence comest thou? Then Satan answered Yahweh and said, from going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. And Yahweh said unto Satan.
That's good enough.
All right, now that's Satan. And that's just the reason why I had that bread, was to show that's his mission, or that's his purpose. He wanders up and down, going everywhere. And the reason why I had this here, because here we got this crow here. See, that's what the crow does. Goes back and forth, he just wanders all over the place. Okay? See, draw a line. That's what happened here with the confusion of tongues. Everybody split and went to the four corners of the earth, or they wandered to and fro from this point. Okay? So now, this cloud, and look, here's something else you should consider. The Tower of Babel happened 101 years after the flood. Noah and his sons are still alive. Because see, Noah lived 950 years total. 600 years he lived on the other side of the flood, that is to say, in the antediluvian age. But on this side of the flood, in the post-diluvian age, he lived 350 years.
That's right.
He was an eyewitness to this. He and his sons were. He and Shem were. They were. See, what it says, and go back to where it says that Elohim came down. Yahweh came down. Go back. 11th chapter.
Genesis 11.
Mm-hmm. And the whole earth was in that one language?
Start with 5.
11 and 5. And Yahweh came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men built it.
Now wait a minute. How did Yahweh come down to see the city? Mm-hmm. Well, when he came up, it's about clouds just floated down and started going around everywhere or something. What?
Yeah.
See, how did that happen? Yahweh come down, I mean, what? Was there a way up above the sun, moon, and stars with a telescope or something? I mean, he said he come down. So what do you mean? See, like I said, Noah was still alive.
So it was Noah.
See, so was Noah.
It was Yahweh and Noah.
Yes.
What?
See, they witnessed, see, and they looked at it. See, they have to, and it would have to be two of them. It would have to be Noah and his son Shem. Why? I have a migratory trick here. Wasn't it two that came down and withstood Pharaoh?
Yeah.
Yes.
See, it would have to be two witnesses. See,
yeah.
See, coming down, and see, here the tower's going up, and this cloud's coming down, and it meet right in the middle, and see, and here you have the confusion of tongues. Mm-hmm. Reverse that Pentecost. Because see, it scattered everybody to the four corners of the earth. Whereas on the day of Pentecost, where did these people come from in the upper room? From the four corners of the earth. They came there and the tongues were straightened out. Now somebody outside the room, they was listening to it. It sounded like a bunch of babbling. It was like, what the heck is going on up in here, man? Must be some drunk folks. And, man, these folks drinking real early in this morning. It's 9 o'clock and they drunk as, you know? And when Peter had to get up and say, no, we're not as drunk as you suppose. We are drunk with the Holy Spirit, but not drunk with no wine, see, drunk with the Holy Spirit. Okay, but now my point is, because of this, people took the forms of government that they learned from Nimrod, all these different religious iconography that they learned, and they went hither and thither, and see, and in a lot of cases they just developed on their own. They said, okay, well, we'll go on and we'll take this part and we'll do something. This is what we think is going to be or what it means, or we'll develop it like this or like that. And that's how all these different religious symbolisms has got out and about worldwide. You know, everything that you look at, you know, I mean, it doesn't matter whether it be the cross or the image of the mother and the baby, even the Muslim image of the crescent and the star, all of that comes from Babylon. From the Tower of Babel, comes from Nimrod. Human government. The basis of it comes from here. Now, you know, somebody said, you mean socialism? Then you're able to practice socialism, communism? I'm just saying the basis of it. See, because the basis of all government is taxation. Now, what you do with that money is the allocation. See, now that's, you know,
that's subject to different philosophical interpretation of what you think, you know. But the basic premise is still the same. You're going to get some money for the people, and the people expect something for their taxes. They expect the streets to be fixed. They expect the trains to come on time. You know, you want your garbage picked up. You want the police protection. You want the fire department. I want my water. I want my electricity. Health and human services, you know, all of that. You expect that. See? And it doesn't matter what system it is. You know, some systems will give more back to the people. Some systems, not so much. Just enough for you to get by, you know. And they'll take all, because in their minds, according to their form of government, we are deserving of the lawgivers, because we're the ones who, we got to run everything. We got to do the heavy thinking that will, you know, ensure that the country is on the right course and, you know, that kind of thing. And we make sure everything, the border is protected and all this kind of stuff. You know, it's no different. It hasn't changed. So that's why I find it ironic, you know, they're talking about wall. And I think it was something I ran across a minute ago, because it was George Patton, General George Patton, who said something like, you know, he says a wall is a monument to the stupidity of man. Here you got people that can traverse mountains and cross oceans, and you think something man is going to put up is going to block somebody? You know? And especially with the technology we have now, walls. The Great Wall, you know, the Great Wall of China, all right, the Great Wall of China is so vast and big, it can be seen from space. That's how big the wall is, and yet it still didn't keep out the Mongols, didn't keep out Genghis Khan. You know? Yeah, it didn't keep them out. It's a good thing for maybe animals, for like wild animals, but for people, maybe not so much.
Yeah,
I mean,
really.
You'd have to really, you know, I mean, you have to think a little bit, you know, and plan a little bit, you know, but it's not insurmountable. I mean, it'll do in the short term, you know, but if somebody really, really want to get to you, it's not going to stop them, you know. It's not really going to stop them. It's not today's technology. See, with rockets and stuff like that. I mean, we got satellites now that can look down on you, you know? Mm-hmm. That kind of thing, you know? But a wall is symbolic, you know? I mean, just for example, the wall here, that was around Jerusalem that protected the temple, you know? It didn't stop Nebuchadnezzar, because he destroyed the wall and the temple, okay? And then somebody put up a man and said, well, Nehemiah built the wall. I said, well, yeah, he did, but it didn't stop Alexander the Great. See, didn't stop the Persians. You know, the Persians was the one that gave him the order, but it didn't stop Alexander the Great. Didn't stop the Romans. It didn't stop the Crusaders. You know, it didn't stop, who else was over there? The British, they ran it for a while. A wall is good, you know, if you're in a stable society, you know, where people are kind of halfway civil to each other. But if not, hey, it's just like anything else, you know, really. And really, the thing you have to understand is that, see, now in the 21st century, we're practically a world without borders. And see, and the way technology is, I mean, we have cell phones. We can get on a cell phone and call somebody in another country. Mm-hmm. Now, where's the wall for that?
Really?
Okay,
yeah.
You see what I'm saying? So it's a different world now. You know, of course, you know, in technology, you know, we got viruses and stuff, and people have to put up firewalls. Okay, so yeah, you know. I'm not going to get off on this wall stuff. It's just, I think it's stupid. It's a boondoggle. But going back to this thing about the two Elohims, okay, we're just showing you Satan is an imitator. So he has the power to appear like the Most High. And to us who don't know, it will seem like the Most High, because, see, he himself is a veil. and he's a bright star on that veil, and you would and because you haven't seen anything brighter before, you think it's a pretty neat thing. And then he's got the moon down. Plate 9, fourth day. This is spiritual temple plate. This is the operation of the Holy Spirit in you. This is showing you being conscious of who you are within you.
Very good.
Okay? Now, what we would do normally, we would take this plate and we would cover this and show you that this is the veil that covers you. Okay? Now, keep that in mind. Now, I'm going to take this plate, and I'm going to put it over this plate, and I'm going to try to infer the same thing as I did with this one, except now I'm trying to show more persnickety what's happening here. Mm-hmm. Here's Satan, this Saturn. He's a bright object in the sky, okay? The veil is up. The veil is up, it's covering, I'm using it like this because the veil is up and it's covering you. Alright, so it's covering you. Body, soul, spirit. Alright, Satan's on the veil. The veil is covering up the spirit. Here's your soul here. Your soul cannot penetrate this veil to see the spirit, but your soul can see Saturn, this bright object. It can see that. Guess what? The moon is down here, which is another bright object. That, in conjunction with the moon, will give you a nice light show for your soul, which is the best thing you've ever seen, because you ain't seen past the veil to see the greater light. You ain't never seen that. So as far as you're concerned, this Saturn and moon show, hey, this is a pretty neat show going on here. Saturn, the bright light, being Satan, because he can appear in any way he wants. The moon representing carnal ordinances. See, and when I say cardinal ordinances, now we know in the direct sense, it represents these 613 ordinances that the Hebrews were under. But see, in the general sense, cardinal ordinances is just representing anything that any man tells you what to do from a physical point of view that makes you think you're worshiping or getting in contact with the divine or a creator. In other words, see, the Muslims, if they sit up and tell you, well, you got to do a Hajj to, you know, you got to do the Hajj to Mecca, you got to, you know, pray five times a day and do this ritual, that ritual, that's carnal ordinances. If the Buddha says, well, you got to do these right moves, right thinking, right thoughts, right, that's carnal ordinances. That's the moon. See? Anything that a man tells you that you have to do that deals with something like ceremonies and rituals and stuff like this from a physical point of view, which is supposed to get you in touch with the divine or the creator, then it's just, hey, it's no different than these. Yahweh never told you to do that, but you took it upon yourself to do it anyway.
Right.
Thinking. And, you know, then, well, I'm going to get in touch with the divine. I'm worshiping Krishna, or I'm worshiping Allah, or I'm worshiping whoever. Because I'm doing these cardinal ordinances that the spirit, some heavenly being, told me to do. You don't know who it was.
Right. You're right.
How would you know the difference?
Yeah.
Because he's appearing as an angel of light. Now, he can appear as an Elohim to you, and he does to many people, but that does not mean he is equal to Elohim. Because why? Because when the veil is ripped and the sun shines through, then this sun obliterates everything. I could have left this up here and just simply said this, okay, here's the veil. Now when the veil's up, here's the sun. the sun shining through, and that just, that lights everything up. See, that's the difference. It's no more, Satan is no more equal with Elohim than the moon is equal with the sun.
Very good.
Why? The moon gets its light from the sun. Satan gets his power from Elohim. Mm-hmm. He can't do anything unless Elohim gives him the power to do so. And look, we went through this a few weeks ago. He knows that if he goes all out and does the best that he can, he's going to get rewarded. What do you mean? He'll be back next week, not next age, but next week in the next set of ages for doing such a good job. And he'll be back. And we, in the next set of ages, will reward him. I say, okay, we'll bring him back. We'll call you something, anything, umfufu or something, I don't know. You know? And let you do your same thing. Just drive him in, rollick again. And that's his, that is his eternal reward. His eternal reward. And listen, I mean, I was just like, I don't know, have you ever watched WWE, you know, wrestling? They got this one guy on there who's a wrestler, and he's lost like 150 matches in a row. He's never won, but that's his job. His job is to lose. And they make a thing out about him losing, you know, or coming close to winning, you know, it's a shtick. But that's his job. He gets paid. He gets paid a lot more than me. I mean, you know, six figures or more, you know, he gets paid just for that, just for doing that, because they're performers, right? So he gets paid for doing that. That's his job. That's the same way Satan is. Satan, he gets paid for doing his job. And he'll be rewarded at the end for it. What's the reward? I'll bring you back so that you can do it again. And he loves that. You know, so that's why in every, not just in this set of ages, but in every set of ages, the mystery of iniquity always goes. See, the mystery of iniquity, that tells you, okay, one, it tells you that he's already unequal. However, in his mind, his goal is to try to be equal. That is his goal. And in doing so, he's going to go all out. He ain't got no mercy. He ain't got no remorse. You just in the way. This is too bad. Because there's nothing going to stop him from getting his reward. The kids would say, I go for mine. I go for mine. And he's going to do the best that he can. And when he is, and people say, well, is he going to be destroyed? Yes, he will. He will be utterly destroyed. Yep, to the lake of fire. And you won't see him anymore for the rest of these, for the set of ages. But when the new set of ages comes in, and when it comes time for the time for a mystery of iniquity, we in him, in Joshua, at that time, we'll bring him out of the closet again and say, okay, boy, I said, go out and do your thing. And be good at it. Because it's his job. He's supposed to do that. So you can't be mad at him, so to speak. He's not Yahweh's adversary. He may be our adversary, but he is an adversary that we can use to help understand the purpose of Yahweh. That's why we say, well, our founder said it best. He said, look, when you understand what Satan's role is in this, see, you'll find out that he's an asset and not a liability in the purpose of Yahweh. Okay? What's it
like? I not speculate with this, but I heard the founder say this, the wrong is right to be wrong, because without the wrong you don't know what right is.
Well, you have to have the principles of, and Yahweh created it. He created the light, darkness, hot, cold, in, out, up, down. You know, I mean, the contrast so that we can look at and compare. Mm-hmm. See,
I learned this in cinematography class, and it was really a trip, that when you understand light, and that's what cinematography deals with. It deals with light and how to use light as a tool, right? But when you understand the properties of light and how to do it, they will show you how you can use light to create darkness. Now that sounds crazy. And I got an educational course on mathematics, and they showed this in a diagram how it is possible for light to create darkness. See? So it's not just something, you know, like if we were living in all light, if everything was all light, see, and you didn't have darkness of contrast, then you wouldn't understand anything beyond that. But because you have darkness, and darkness is necessary because you have to have that to create contrast in objects and things. And I teach you that. See, so darkness is a necessary tool and a component of light because you have to have both to create the contrast and the shadings and stuff. Because sometimes if you have too much light, then it washes out whatever it is you're trying to look at. So you have to have some darkness to create a contrast so that you can see certain things. And certain types of contrast can evoke certain types of emotions. That's why certain films are made the way they are. Sometimes they'll go, you know, to create real stark emotions, they may shoot it in black and white. That will do it like that. See, or certain ways that they'll shoot so that they can, you know, like I say, the lighting is just as important. I tell people this, is the lighting is just as important because you're painting with light. You're painting using light to create the contrast so people can see what it is that you're showing and make it evoke you in a way to make you feel something. Mm-hmm. It's designed that way. And science, and believe me, I didn't think that until I got to school and started doing this, that scientists have broke this stuff down. You know, I mean, even to the point, like in mathematics, they even have a mathematical formula for beauty. Would you believe that? See, that kind of thing. So, I mean, you'd be surprised at what you know, Yahweh has allowed man to discover. Because Yahweh has given mankind a measure of these attributes. So that he could understand it. See? And man has that. And look at the world we live in now compared to 6,000 years ago. And yet, you know, people still have the same emotions, you know, the same carnal outlook. It's just that we, you know, so-called advanced technologically, okay, all right, we don't get into a chariot with a horse, you know, go around, but we do get into a chariot that has a mechanical horse in it, okay? That kind of, so, I mean, it's just all upgraded and, you know, and we're more...
sophisticated.
Yeah. We are more encased in the physical than more so than ever. I mean, we're surrounded by our technology. I mean, if we was to have an EMP pulse, like an electromagnetic pulse, and it knocked out all the electricity around it, and we'd be in the dark, you know, the cars wouldn't run, you know, couldn't turn the lights on, no power, and you know, what would you do then? You'd have to start, most people wouldn't know how to start a fire, you know, just to keep going, you know. I mean, unless you have some matches, but even a lighter is a technological thing, but,
right.
You know, you ever watch the people on, Naked and Afraid, and they'd be out there, trying to get there, they'd be calling, they'd be trying to say, man, come on, get that fire going, man. Shoot. If people had to go back and something like that, the basics like that, most of us wouldn't survive.
Right.
Yeah. Really. Go out there, you wouldn't know what to drink, you know. Not all water is good water. That kind of thing, you know. And then nighttime come, you know, ain't no street lights, you know. And it just gets dark when the sun goes down and the animals get to roaming around, you know, whatnot. You know, you'd be, you know, like a Naked Afraid, you'd be in there, little hugging, you'd say, wait, did you hear something out there? Oh, what is that, a bear or a cougar or whatever, you know, something. What you got? You ain't got no, maybe you got a fire starter. If not, you better have a sharp stick or something, you know, ready. Tell you, But this two Elohim thing, I don't even know how that got about. Well, in part, because didn't he used to preach that they said something about, I'm talking about the other side. They said something about Lucifer was physical and he had sex with Eve or something like that.
He materialized physical.
Yeah, he materialized physical and had sex with Eve and produced Cain. You know, that somebody, they came out with something like that.
Something
to that effect. Yeah, you know, that kind of thing, you know. It's just a misreading of the scriptures, not taking the time to look at what our founder laid out. Because if you would just read his textbook, go over his transcripts, listen to the audios, the pamphlets, and examine these charts, Yahweh will show you what it is. See, look, he thinks he's equal. That's why he's exalted. That's why we say he's self-exalted. He's exalting himself above and beyond what his station is, thinking he is like the Most High, when he's nowhere like it. But like you say, see, when this veil is on you, see, you're going through whatever cardinal ordinances you believe in, and see, and you're living in mystery Babylon, and then here's the one that's sitting up here on the throne. Now, he's not sitting on your throne, because this is an illusion.
Very good.
See, he cannot sit on this throne because he is on the throne.
Right.
Now somebody said, well, wait a minute, ain't that the Holy Spirit? No. Like this, that's the law of the Spirit, because the veil is up. That's the law of the Spirit back there. And he's covering up who you are. But once this veil is rent, see, and he's revealed, now that's the Holy Spirit. He was there all along, but this veil kept him hidden from you. That's his job. Didn't we read that in Ezekiel? Maybe we should read that. We got on a tangent because we read the jewels. But go back, I want to read that one part. Right after the jewels, the stones.
Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so.
Now he's the anointed cherub that covereth, and Yahweh set him like that for that purpose, to cover. This veil, the second departmental veil, covers it. It covered this. It blocked your view of what was in here. That's his job. This is a veil. His job is to cover you. It's to cover and to block your view. This is a veil. I'm talking about human government. Human government is a veil. It is designed to block your view from Yahweh. Now that doesn't mean that we ain't going to obey the laws of the land. That's not what I'm saying.
Right.
What I'm saying is that human government is designed for you to put your faith in it. That's why you have a national anthem, a national flag, you pledge allegiance to the government, you know, that kind of thing. You respect the offices of the president, the senators, the representatives. You're going to respect the law. You pay your taxes, or else they'll come after you. Your income taxes, yeah, they'll come. Yep. And that makes you a good citizen. See? And because if you be a good citizen, you pay your taxes, we'll let you have a little freedom. You got freedom of speech, freedom of religion, you know, freedom of incrimination. We'll let you have a gun, own a gun. But in the meanwhile, you're going to pay. You're going to pay the taxes. You're going to pay respect to the government. See?
And it doesn't matter. Some people say, well, that sounds like socialism because that's what they do. Well, all governments do that, even if it's a religious one. You know, because even in England, they would say, God save the king, or God save the queen. See? Even on our dollar bill, it'll say, in God we trust. So it's not impossible to have a, you know, government by religion. In fact, for the most part of human history, it was always government by religion. Because a lot of times, a city would have a patron god or goddess. This city belongs to the goddess so-and-so, or to the god so-and-so. This is who we worship. And when they go to war, it would be like one nation against another, but in reality, it would be that person's god against the other god. Classic case, the Philistines and the Israelites.
Right.
The Philistines would say, Dagon is our god. And whenever the Philistines fought against Israel, and if they ever beat them, they wouldn't say, well, we Philistines beat the Israelites. No, they would say, our God, Dagon, defeated your God, Yahweh. That's what they would say. Because from their point of view, they look at, like, the gods are above the sun, moon, and stars, and they look at the human beings like we would play, like, chess pieces, you know, moon here and moon there and that kind of thing. Very famous battle of the Greeks, the city of Troy, the Helen of Troy, and all of that. When you really study the story about that's called the Iliad. When you read the story of the Iliad, it was really the battle of gods. It was one set of gods versus another, using humans as their pawns. So that's always been like that throughout, you know. And see, and now these systems, these governmental systems, they have become the gods themselves. Let's take the communist system, for example. The communist system was developed by a man named Karl Marx. And there was a couple other folks involved. I think another guy was Friedrich Engels. And when you stop and think about it, and I was having a conversation with a person who came from a socialist country, the three people in the communist world that they admire the most is Karl Marx, Friedrich Engels, and Vladimir Lenin. Those are the three, and those three, it would be like a trinity. Even though the communists are not religious, because they're not, you know, it's an atheistic system, but those three are the principal people that the communist world worships and revere. Lenin was so revered that they kept his body preserved for decades in his coffin. That's how revered he was. See? And there's still people that still practice the communist system, like the Chinese, but now what they've done, they've modified it and they got a little bit of capitalism. But that's not unusual if you really understood the communist system model. Because the communist system model is a threefold thing. First, it starts off with capitalism. Then it moves into socialism. And then it moves into what is called communism, which is supposedly the great utopia where the state owns everything and everybody is equal and everybody is provided for because the state provides everything. And the state, you know, is to be worshipped. All honor and glory goes to the state.
Politburo.
See? Huh?
They call Politburo.
Yeah.
Then people rule.
Yeah, I mean, but the thing about it is, see, it's the idea, the system that they use, and you can argue and say, well, the communists, the socialist system, they take money from you and this and that. And let me tell you something. It is no better or no worse than any other system that has lived. Okay, because people say, well, we're Christians and stuff. Well, I've seen Christian, look here, we got Papal Rome right here. That was an empire. It was a Christian empire, all right? And they was just as dirty as any other empire that lived. Okay, they went and conquered people, dead people, persecuted people, enslaved people. just like the other empires did, in the name of God, Christianity, Jesus Christ, etc. See, you can do whatever you want in whatever name you want. See, the Christians, they, you know, they just like these other folks, in England, they have their own empire. They've done things too in the name of Christianity. In fact, it's because of England, Christianity got the biggest spread. The Bible. That's why the majority of the world speaks English. Because of the British Empire and the Bible. See? So you can sit up and say, well, one system is better than the other, or this, that, and the other, but really, when you stop and think about it, they're all of the adversary. So how can any of them be any good? Oh yeah, we gotta live in it. We gotta deal with it. You know, I would rather live here in America than to live in, say, some other country that didn't have certain rights or certain things, because it's what I'm used to. See? But everybody don't have all of that. And see, if people can sit up and argue about capitalism, because see, capitalism, see, you can make money with capitalism, but here's the biggest flaw of capitalism. It is dependent upon cheap labor. See? And that's what this country started on. It's a capitalist country that started off with cheap labor. See? What do you mean? Slavery. Well, who was enslaved first? First, the native peoples were enslaved first. But because they were enslaved on their own land, they was able to run away and go into the interior. So they had to get other folks. Then here comes the black folks. But cheap labor. And that lasted for 150 years or so, cheap labor. And then after slavery, the problem was, okay, how are we going to get cheap labor? So they start making convicts. Doing convicts and stuff. Segregation. See, then after a while somebody hit up on the idea, well, we can use these immigrants from across the border. Why? Because they're not citizens, so they can't sue for any rights. And we can pay them what we want. Pay them less than what we pay the Americans. Oh, I know. I competed with immigrant labor before. And I see, you know, tell that idiot. I watched that idiot get on TV tonight, and he was sitting up there, and he was talking about the immigrants take away jobs from African Americans and other people. No, they don't. You know, it's only because native people in this country don't want the jobs they want to do. See, nobody wants to go out and pick tomatoes in the hot sun for 10, 12 hours, you know, for X amount of money. See? And besides, I can tell you something for black folks. And see, my parents and their generation, they grew up picking cotton. So they know something about back-breaking agricultural work. And because of that, my mom, and I'm sure along with thousands of other black mothers who experienced something like that, they impressed upon their children, go to school, get an education, so you don't have to do this kind of stuff.
Right.
My mother impressed that very hard on us, so that, you know, so you don't have to do this kind of stuff. Get you an education. And that's what a lot of black folks did. That's why you don't see black folks out in the fields no more. Because a lot of black folks got education.
Washing cars.
They go work at the post office. Something, you know. Yeah, I'm just telling you. Because that's... I worked in a place, and it's not far from here, Rancho Cucamonga. It was a plastics factory. And they were moving. They were going to move this stuff to Texas. And so I got a job working there through some temporary agency. And I'm telling you, it was hard work for $2.29 an hour. Okay? And it was at night, midnight shift. And I mean, it was some hard work, dirty work and stuff. Just, you know, machines, you had to work on these machines. It was monotonous work. But I'm telling you something. The shift was from 11 p.m. to 7 a.m. 3 o'clock in the morning was lunchtime. At 3 o'clock at lunchtime, they would take a break. They stop the machines and you take a half-hour break for lunch, 3 o'clock in the morning. I've seen too many times where a white person and a black guy, they would get off of lunch, they'd take their girls off and throw it down and say, the hell with this, and walk out the shop.
It would go bad.
And they'd say, I ain't doing this, not for no $2.29 an hour. But the immigrants that were there, they were illegally, they were there, and you knew who they were. They ain't said nothing. They just quietly go eat their lunch, they get up, go back to work. No complaints, no nothing. That's why they liked them. Yeah. Whereas the other folks, the Americans, they go, man, I'm going to And that's why, I'm telling you. But the immigrants, they didn't complain. And that's, I'm telling you. And your people say, well, we got to need a wall to block these folks out. Look, if you really want to stop them, then you're just going to have to penalize the businesses that hired them. But they're not going to do that. Because that would cripple the economy if they start doing that. Because this economy thrives on cheap labor. That is the truth of it. Right? And it's always been that way. Unless you're going to radically change something, which I doubt, that's the way it's going to be. Okay? All right. I don't know how I got into that. But does that answer the, this is asking a question about this two Elohim business.
Yeah.
Okay? Because Lucifer does not have the power to create. He has the power to imitate.
Very good.
See, that's the thing. And if you don't know any better, you'll think the imitation is real. If you don't know any better. That's why the veil has to be ripped. To be revealed who you really are. Now, this is not the imitation. This is the real thing. See, that's in you. Okay? Anything else?
Well, so many things that people come up with, they can't prove it. And sometimes it's very simple scriptures that would disprove it, but somehow they're entrenched.
Well, I can't speak for everybody. Only thing I could say is simply this. You have to review the record. And a lot of people don't want to do that because... You know, it's a funny thing. We'll sit up here and we'll brag. We're a school and we're not a church. And this is the highest school, the highest learning in the world. And yet you won't even open the book and read about the explanations of these charts. I know people in IDMR that have never read the whole textbook. And some of those who have still don't understand it. Because they don't know how to research it. Or these charts. See, when you get to a point, if you don't understand what's on these charts, then you'll come up with anything. And it blows my mind when people say, well, you know, I really don't have anything to say. I really don't know what to talk about in this doctrine. And you're surrounded by seven, you know, magnificent charts that the founder drew, and you really don't have anything to say about anything. I find that amazing in this school, see. But all you have to do is just take a chart, just go through it. But the problem is, see, we as a school have gotten lazy. I remember a time when it was when we were coming up, we were young, and we were in our 20s, and we didn't have all this technological stuff at our disposal. We had to walk down to the library and look stuff up. Okay? But it was a joy to do that. To find out and then find out the information that was in it, you know, things like that and about this vision. But now it's like, I don't know, people don't see the relationship anymore of these charts to this generation. You know, like young people, I don't know, they look at this, I guess they compare it and they say, oh, this is old stuff, you know, this is church stuff or something, and I sit back and I think, I said, what could we do to make an outreach to them or to show them that it's just as relatable to them, you know, as it was to me when I was their
age? That's a very good question.
Hmm?
I said, that's a very good question.
See,
no motivation.
Is it what?
No motivation.
Well, you know, I think it's something Dr. Kim even said in the textbook about young people, and that was true then, and it's always true in each young, in each generation of young people, that they see the hypocrisy of the previous generation.
That's right.
And they say they don't want to be a part of it. Okay. And I'm sure at this point, young people, they see what has happened in the Roman Catholic Church and all these other religions and stuff like that. And then when you start talking about the Bible, and I know that people will sit up and talk, and there's some harsh critics just of the Bible in itself, because for a lot of people, they think the Bible justifies certain types of behavior like slavery, mm-hmm. or treatment of the way women are treated, you know, or certain minorities, that kind of thing, you know. So they feel the Bible justifies that. Or they say, well, the Bible was written by man, and man can say anything and write anything. And people will even say, well, what is a book that's got the, you know, that talks about a bunch of desert people? What does that got to do with me? You know, that kind of thing. You know, so it's an uphill battle, because, and it's just the times. Because, see, as we get closer toward, you know, I mean, we're in the last days and stuff, and the adversary, he's doing all that he can to confuse and conceal. You know? And he's doing a good job at it. He's done a damn good job, because he wants his reward. He wants his reward, so he's doing a damn good job at it.
Yeah.
See? I don't know what the answer to that question is, other than we do take the advantage of the technology we have. That's why we're live streaming on Facebook. We got our YouTube videos. Anything else we could do, to further this doctrine and get people to notice and ask questions, that's all we can do right now. I don't know anything else to do or what to do. Now, of course, I'm always open to suggestions. Of course, there's always travel, the business of places, okay? You know, so, and we have brother around, you know, like me, I'm going to go to Jamaica next month and visit them. They have a seminar, 2-day seminar, the last weekend in February. So if anybody out there feel like you might want an excursion to Jamaica for the weekend, yeah, there's a chance to go visit some brothers. They would love to see you there. In April, I intend to go with the Lewises to Africa, to Zambia, visit our brother in there. So, I mean, this is the thing that we find ourselves at. We can't, I know, we look around as hard, you know, I mean, it seems like, you know, we're not doing anything. There's just so few of us, but our doctrine is powerful and strong, and I truly believe it, that what we're doing does make a difference, and it is worthwhile, and I just hope that other folks, you know, that who watch us and are edified by us, you know, hopefully that they would be moved to do things as well. You wanted to say something?
Yeah, I was thinking, when we went to Tampa a few times, I listened to Judith Turner, and she would take things from current events and relate it to things like the charts, and it made it more real and more now, and not just things that you read in the past. And a couple of times I've heard her, and it was really inspiring to bring it closer to what, you know, who is Yahweh, and related to our everyday life.
Well, Dr. Kelly did the same thing. You could read, if you would go back and read his transcripts or certain lectures, he talks about certain things too, you know, in certain events. He gets into like the Vietnam War, which was happening at the time, and other things that were happening, certain notable political figures. I remember him talking about Pierre Salinger. Most of the time, but he was a very important political figure in the Nixon administration, things like that. And I'm just saying, you know, Dr. Kennedy did comment on things. I mean, he even commented on, at the time, when he first came to this country, the South Korean preacher, Sung Yung Moon. So when he first came here, I was in the 70s, and he commented on that, talking about he was a reincarnation of Jesus Christ and all this. You know, there's a microphone there if you want to say something. So, I mean, he did, that's true, he did comment on things, you know, so
I have nothing against that, but I would just say that learn the charts first before you can get into, you know. I would say learn the charts. Go ahead.
Yeah, one time I heard the founder, and the Clifford Kingdon, say, "I worse than that, the president of Egypt will be assassinated." It had happened.
The who?
Anwar Sadat, because he gets the name.
Anwar Sadat. Oh, okay.
He will be assassinated. It had happened.
Mm-hmm.
Because the name he had, Sadat, Sidel.
Hmm. Interesting. It's a lot of things he did. He did come in a lot. So I remember, oddly enough, I remember Dr. Kinley gave credit to Dr. Harris for making a prophecy earlier that in 1 year where he said that Nixon was going to resign, you know, by before the end of the year. And so Dr. Kelly gave that credit, you know. So I'm just saying, you know, there are things, but to get to that level, though, you got to study these charts.
Yeah.
You can't get around it, okay? And people think, you know, I mean, you can copy people if you want to, but that's not the same as knowing it for yourself. We'll do what we can to point these things out, you know, this, that, and the other, but you're going to have to take the time and view the record yourselves and allow Yahweh to reveal it to you so that you know it. It won't be a thing like, well, I heard so-and-so say it on the floor, so it must be right because they seem like they're smart. No, you took the time and you looked it up. You researched it, and Yahweh showed you within yourself, so that now you can go out and talk about it because you know it, not because of somebody else, but because Yahweh showed it to you. See? Okay? All right. We're out of time here. I appreciate your time and patience. Again, my only exhortation is take the time and look at these things. Look these things up. Yahweh will show you these things if you take the time to look. If you don't give a damn, he don't either. And that's a real thing. But if you be importunist, see, you be importunist, Yahweh will notice you. Trust me on that. See, okay. Thank you very much for your time and your patience and with those few words. Thank you.
That concludes another lecture sponsored by the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. We hold classes on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 to 9:30 on Sundays from 11 to 1. We have a Spanish class every fourth Sunday of the month from 9:30 to 10:45. All donations will be accepted by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Let's all stand and be dismissed. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling, present you falling for the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua Messiah, Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both for all times now and forever. Let us all say hallelujah.
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 Oh, I got a quick question.
What's up?
Since we have, like, a pretty good slush funds from the cans, can I go and get Irene some flowers in a card and take it to her tomorrow?
Sure.
Hospital?
Sure.
Sure.
That would be great.
Yes. As long as it's okay with your officers, you're fine.
Yeah, she said Arrowhead.
Oh, let me say something right quick. I just wanted to give a shout out to the Brooklyn, New York class because Dr. Joe Brown died the other day. And we met him when we was on our travels, and we did visit Brooklyn, New York. So I did get a chance to meet him and talk to him, and I just found out that he died. So I just wanted to extend condolences to the Brooklyn, New York class and to his family.
How did you know it was Shem with Noah?
Because Shem is the lineage of the seed of that seed. You know, Joshua is 63 generations from Adam, and Shem is in that generation.
And his other sons?
Well, I don't know about his other sons. I mean, you know, I mean they were probably alive, but you know, but Shem is the one through the seed. Abraham is descended from the line of Shem. So
So that would be the righteous seed coming down through Shem. Okay.